History tells us that sub-Saharan Africans were brought to this land in bondage to fulfill a life sentence of involuntary servitude. And for the most part, they surrendered to this fate until 1863, when President Abraham Lincoln issued the Emancipation Proclamation and set them free. But by that time, hundreds of thousands had been born into and died in bondage. Despite staggering odds, there were those who had managed to defy an inhumane system by escaping. They embarked on a harrowing journey to freedom and self-determination. Those daring souls fled into a myriad of wild landscapes, hills, dense woods, swamps, mountains, and caves, living both above and below ground. Their lives under siege, many not only survived, but thrived in the most extreme conditions. These self-exiled slaves carved out a new destiny for themselves and their loved ones. They lived autonomously, the fortunate among them never returning to captivity. This is the empowering story of the Maroons. So who were the Maroons, and where exactly did they come from?
Yep, my name is Dr. Terrence Weick. I'm an associate professor here at the University of South Carolina. Maroon is one name for a group of people who escaped from slavery and who established communities or established, you know, short-term camps outside of slavery. And in the case of Florida, we have Africans who escaped from plantations in the Carolinas and Georgia and other parts of the Southeast, and went into Seminole territory. And the word Maroon, I don't know if anyone has talked about this, you know, comes from the Spanish word cimarrón, and that is, there's some debate about what that means in terms of, is it an appropriate word to use for these communities, because some people feel like it's a derogatory label to use. For instance, if you go to the Dominican Republic, which is one place where I've done some archaeological field work, you can stop by a roadside stand and you'll find signs for pollo cimarrón, wild chicken. So, you know, anything wild, right, you know, it takes on the label of cimarrón, and that's how the early Spanish chroniclers kind of viewed not only cattle, you know, but also people. So they started calling people this word cimarrón, and so it derived, you know, from basically this agricultural situation. These colonists were labeling people and cattle and the landscape, but there are some descendant communities who have taken this label nonetheless and redefined it or claimed it, such as descendants in Jamaica who call themselves proudly Maroons. Other descendants in maybe in places like Suriname, they might not so be so keen on this term, but we in the United States and in North America refer to folks as runaways or fugitives Maroons, and that's the legacy, you know, of colonists who and slaveholders who were describing people who were, you know, leaving the system of forced labor and were seeking something, you know, beyond that. You know, they had a vision of being free from harsh servitude and abuse and violation and all kinds of things. It's important that we not generalize too much, because we're talking about a lot of different types of people, and they had different motivations. They had different backgrounds. They spoke different languages, you know, European languages, Spanish, French, English, different African language, you know, Twi and Congo languages. Some were born in Africa, some were born on plantations in the Americas. So, simply, Maroons were a diverse group of people of African descent who escaped from slavery and who tried to establish free communities. In the big picture, we have to keep in mind that people who became Maroons have a history that transcends slavery and transcends the Americas, transcends North America. There are primary sources and there are oral traditions that talk about Africans escaping from slavery in Africa itself, you know, and that goes back hundreds of years. One could even extend it to the African diaspora in places like modern-day Iraq, where the so-called Zanj Africans escaped from slavery and they rose up against their Muslim, you know, slaveholders and established this multicultural rebellion that was able to hold out for a whole generation, you know. So that's another part of the wider history of how, you know, this is a global story that we're talking about, and slavery in Africa lasted a lot longer than it did here in the Americas. So it's important to keep that in mind. It's also important to keep in mind that Africans came to the Americas with knowledge, with memories, with understandings of family, of herbalism, of agriculture, of many different things that equipped them to not only to work on plantations but also to seek their freedom. You know, whether we think of it in terms of Africans who became prisoners of war and then ended up in the slave trade, or we think of it in terms of Africans who were enslaved and came here to South Carolina and grew rice, you know, and for slaveholders who were aware of the fact that they knew how to grow rice and they chose those particular parts of Africa, you know, to enslave people from, because they knew what that meant for their bottom line.
The Maroons are Africans, Africans here in the diaspora who are seeking freedom and independence. And when we look at the Maroons, as I tell you, they have that uncontrollable desire for freedom and they will go and escape and create societies. The Maroons, many times people try to narrow it just to say folks in Jamaica or to in Suriname or to Guyana. But I tell folks, there's any African people who are now seeking freedom and now creating their own societies, creating fabrics of societies in the pockets that they go into, say, the Great Dismal Swamp, the Okefenokee, in coastal Georgia, coastal South Carolina, going on down to Florida, that will then connect with Native Americans that have alliances and relationships there that now create, again, what we know, another group of Seminole, a group of other Africans who are now called African Seminoles. And I let folks understand the Maroons are those Africans who are seeking freedom. Or in Haiti, we're going to say Nagmaran, runaway Africans. Again, those who have, say, absconded off and seeking freedom, freedom seekers.
Under the watchful eye of slave owners, henchmen, law enforcement, and traders, both slaves and Maroons found resourceful ways to communicate with one another.
So in terms of the question of how is it that people communicated across plantations and across slavery systems, across colonial territories and Native American territories, there's various ways that this happened. One is that plantations and slavery systems could not have operated if people were all chained to a tree and forced to work that way, right? People had to have some level of freedom of movement, you know, just so that the basic tasks that were required to be done every day could happen. There were people whose job it was to leave, you know, either the plantation or the immediate slavery context and maybe run errands for the slaveholder. In some cases, we have enslaved people serving as so-called drivers, who they would actually be in charge of managing, you know, and other enslaved people. So that was part of it, and just starting with the whole labor situation, beginning there, you know, and thinking about people who might have ran errands for slaveholders, carried messages back and forth between plantations or from plantation to city or within city if they were enslaved within cities. We had folks who served as carriage drivers, you know, who would, through the course of their work, you know, shuttling slaveholders or others around, they would have opportunities to talk with people. Slavery systems, people had off days. I mean, it didn't happen very often, but maybe at one day a week, or they would have free days where they might tend to gardens or visit people. In some cases, slaveholders wrote passes for people to travel between plantations, and in some cases that was because they had family, you know, in the region, right? So these are various instances. And sometimes during those free days, they might go to some kind of regional market where they would interact with people and sometimes sell things that they grew on the provision grounds, or pots that they might have made, or, you know, various things. Another way that people communicated, you know, even during slavery days and all the captivity and confinement that limited them, was some folks might have got word of things by way of Africans who were sailors. There's a lot of history to this. Paul Gilroy, you know, a scholar in the UK, you know, talks about, you know, how there was a large proportion, like maybe over 20% of the English Navy at one point, you know, was of people of African descent. It's quite large. As I said earlier, for people who were interested in developing or joining Maroon communities, you know, having information of a wider landscape and current events was important, because they needed to know there was some place to go. They needed to know there were some possibilities for finding, you know, some sense of freedom. There were clearly no guarantees, but it certainly helps if you have information before you leave to do these things. And they weren't this sort of act of escaping, you know, was punishable by death. You know, people literally risk their lives. And for people who were to organize these communities, the ante was even higher, because those were the first people who were would have been targeted, and the sentences and the punishments were much higher for those people, because, you know, slaveholders and colonists understood, you know, that, you know, if you're going to extinguish these communities, you're going to take the head off of the community, right, in terms of the leadership. So, but nonetheless, people still communicated, and they still connected. The soldiers who fought against these Africans and Seminoles would often lament about how many communities, including Abrahamstown, were actually deserted by the time the soldiers arrived at these communities. So, in the case of Abrahamstown, one of the only depictions of the town is the town set on fire, even though we have a nice kind of landscape shot of things. And but it's important to understand that these communities weren't, when they were under attack, you know, by the military, oftentimes it was empty buildings that the military encountered because of these communication networks. And the U.S. military, I can point to specific sources that talk about how, you know, it was either Native American or African, you know, they didn't spell out, you know, exactly how it worked, but, you know, they had been tipped off, these communities, to the coming of the soldiers or slave patrols. And so it worked in various ways. You know, it is one of the reasons why the United States military had a hard time defeating the Seminole forces, because there were lines of communication that were informing folks who were resisting against the military U.S. expansion.
Well, how are the children to do? Are the queen quite head from the body of the Gullah Geechee Nation? Are the natives to tell all and things like that? I'm so glad that the children to deal with we are. So many people have never been to the Gullah Geechee Nation, but St. Helena Island, that I'm a native of, is basically the center point of the Gullah Geechee Nation, which begins at Jacksonville, North Carolina, and runs southward to Jacksonville, Florida. It encompasses all of these islands in the Atlantic Ocean called the Sea Islands, and then extends 30 to 35 miles inland to the mainland, to the St. John's River. And you'll see in the Gullah Geechee Nation's flag a tree right in the center, those human bodies intertwined together, that we can never be disconnected from one another. Well, that's what would happen in the Bushava, the Brushava. It would unite us further together. And so in those settings, people would, yes, praise God, and had faith that a better day was going to come. And they would shout all evening and things like that. But they would also pass on messages to each other if there was a way to escape, if there was something else that was going to come up. The uprisings, like Denmark Vesey's uprising, for instance, with Gullah Jack, the planning went on in these types of places, praise houses, and then that eventually entered the church.
Escaping was not an easy feat. How did they manage to escape, and where did they go?
In terms of how the Maroons escaped, there were various ways they did that. There were various circumstances. Some folks would wait until they had an opportune time when no one was paying attention. You know, maybe it was during a particularly challenging situation, like where there was some kind of storm or natural disaster or something. You know, under the cover of night. You know, using the natural circumstances and environment and landscape to their advantage. Other folks would develop elaborate plans and rebel, you know, collectively, or, you know, make plans to escape collectively, and, you know, they would leave in groups. Certainly there were networks of people, you know, even though folks were forced to labor on plantations or labor in cities, you know, people talked, you know, and they talked across plantation borders, you know, and they talked across geographic borders, and people, you know, would exchange, you know, information. So that's one thing that scholars talk about, is the flow of information and news, you know, amongst enslaved people, amongst free people. And that certainly was important, because as someone who was going to escape, you had to know where slave patrols would be and where military forces would be, and, you know, the various things that would work to your disadvantage, you would want to know that ahead of time. So, you know, for those folks who were successful, those things were very helpful. So knowledge was just as important as taking a gun with you, you know, when you escaped, in terms of what they took with them. And I think that's an important one. In some cases, you know, people would leave with clothing, and certainly arms were very important to them. Taking people with them, you know, there's all kinds of things that one had to consider. The flip side was that you had to be willing to carry whatever you took with you, you know, so you were weighted down by the things you took, and many people, I think, probably didn't escape with very much, because it was to their disadvantage to take anything more than they needed. But people had to make those subjective choices when they were thinking about escaping and thinking about how to escape. People often escaped to places where it was hard for their pursuers to chase them and to get at them, and so places like Florida were and low country areas, you know, of the east coast of what is today the United States were important places, you know, wetlands, because these were places where it would have been hard for people to chase them, and it would have been hard for hounds to track them through, you know, the wetlands. The environment was also important, because it supplied them with, people who chose to escape, with resources, whether it be food resources, wild game, whether it be raw materials to build houses, whether it be herbs to heal them or, you know, fortify their health. So there are a variety of types of landscapes that Africans escape to, oftentimes wetland areas or highly forested areas, you know, more wetlands in places like Florida and Lowcountry and maybe parts of Louisiana. And there were more minor cases in, you know, mountainous areas. But in North America, one had to consider the Native American presence in more mountainous areas, such as the Cherokees, who often were allied with slaveholding regimes. One, because it was in their geopolitical interest to have allies who had, you know, who were powerful and who wouldn't necessarily attack them, although that didn't necessarily work for most people. But it also was a potentially lucrative endeavor for Native Americans to police the borders, you know, between the mountains, you know, where some folks like the Cherokee lived, and, you know, the other areas, you know, where there were slaveholding regimes set up and plantations. Maroons escaped to many different types of environments. One can look back, you know, into, you know, some of the earlier scholarship, even, you know, after chroniclers stopped writing about them, and, you know, there were people like W.E.B. Du Bois and others who were writing about African American history back in, you know, the early 20th century, late 19th century, and who were talking about different travel routes, you know, along which people would escape to. So, you know, clearly the Appalachian Mountains would be one of them. Clearly the Low Country area in Florida would be another place. The Texas-Mexico border, what is today Texas and Mexico, would be another area. And then, of course, people traveled some cases up north and joined what became known as the Underground Railroad. So, and you know, people didn't respect, you know, modern day boundaries. Some folks traveled into the Caribbean, and some folks got on boats and tried to go back to Africa.
So the Great Dismal Swamp is currently located in southeastern Virginia, northeastern North Carolina, and when I think currently, I think of what is most, for the most part, it's U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service National Wildlife Refuge, and that swamp, that refuge, is about 190 square miles in size, and then there's a little bit of a park, a North Carolina State Park, that runs contiguous with it. But overall, the 190 or so square miles represents about 10% of that original Great Dismal Swamp. So the original was, by geological and other estimates, around 2,000 square miles in size before the Civil War. So it was very large by almost any standard, and it was roughly the size of current Rhode Island, the size, a little bigger than that. Before 1607, one of these things that we've determined through a field work, which I'll get into in a bit, was that Native Americans or Indigenous Americans have long used the swamp. Shouldn't come as much of a surprise, but we didn't know that necessarily for sure before this project. But certainly we're finding materials that go back thousands of years in Native Americans using the swamp one way or the other. So there's this long history, this cultural history to this great huge landscape, even if it's, like I said, today only about 10% of its size. It's still no small place, even at 10%. But still, we know there's this deep history coming up to the colonial period. And we know that with all that complex colonial interaction, as well as Native American interactions among themselves around that early 1600s, right? Meanings of that place changed, but the fact that there was cultural meaning remained strong. Going into the 1600s, what we see in the region of southeastern Virginia, Virginia in general, and North Carolina as it came to be, was the rise of this sort of system or process of enslavement, right, of people of African descent. So when you have colonials coming in, usurping the various tribal lands, including the swamp to a degree, from Native Americans or Indigenous Americans, and then by about 1660, maybe 1680 at the latest, this sort of enslavement system of people of African descent cements itself in the region. But we also know that the first Africans, enslaved Africans, were brought over to Jamestown in 1619. So there's 40 years there or so, maybe even 60, right, where this system was sort of emerging, all right, before it really cemented. So the point of bringing that up is, in part, is to remind ourselves how important it is to recognize that these sort of brutal, exploitative sort of labor systems and cultural systems, for that matter, like enslavement, lead to a variety of different ways people are going to resist or defy those conditions. And one of them that was very pretty well studied by scholars across this hemisphere, right, is this process known or practice known as marooning. All right, so wherever slavery existed, anything like slavery or enslavement, people marooned. And what does maroon mean? And the simplest way to put it is they tried to permanently remove themselves from the conditions of enslavement. So this took a variety of forms, but certainly the one that is the forms or type of marooning that's most common, or at least most talked about in some ways, is where people came to inhabit these kinds of remote parts of the landscape, be it the Dismal Swamp or a mountain range or hill country that colonials hadn't quite settled for whatever reason, enslavers hadn't settled. They become very, very attractive kinds of landscapes to people who are marooning. And so again, the Dismal Swamp is certainly at 2,000 square miles before the Civil War. It was hard to miss this one, right? So if you're enslaved or in conditions like that, even indentured servitude, you're going to see that swamp as a potential haven, right? A permanent place to go permanently. Going into the 1700s, we're basically a continuation, right, of that enslavement of people of African descent, going all the way into the 1800s, of course, up to the Civil War. So, in a nutshell, what we expect, if you think of population movement into the swamp, initial, like before 1600 and then 1600 up to about 1660 or maybe 1640, we might expect predominantly indigenous Americans or Native Americans to be the people going in to live permanently or semi-permanently in the swamp. But after 1640, 1660, maybe 1680, we're expecting that the main flood of people going in after that are probably marooning Africans and African Americans. And that would continue that way up until about 1800. It was around 1800 that we begin to see, it's a little earlier than that, 1760s, but 1800 is the canal boom, as I call it, in the swamp. But in 1763, the adventurers to drain the Dismal Swamp, the Great Dismal Swamp, this was a sort of a prototypic corporation type endeavor. They had figured out a way to begin to try to transform that swamp, make it into something worth money or worth, you know, that could generate wealth. Despite all that, or even though all that, what I just said is true, the Dismal Swamp was an extremely safe place in terms of, for Maroons, particularly those going in the interior, extremely safe relative, or thinking of in particular, right, those groups of people who might go out and try to track them down and bring them back to the outside world. Probably more so than any landscape that we are aware of, any place in the world that people marooned. And this is right up there in terms of very safe, right? If that's what you want to do, get far enough into the swamp and you're pretty safe from that, you know, the encroachments, right? Even after 1800, I think that was probably pretty true.
Most Maroons would rather face life-threatening perils in the wild on the run than be recaptured, brutally punished, or put to death. But how did they survive?
And of course, in the 1760s, with these sort of European investors and so on, the main source of labor were enslaved Africans or African Americans. So what we're basically talking about then is these investors bringing in supervisors or overseers to see a labor force of enslaved people dig canals and cut trees. And that's, again, the first effort at this was in the early 1760s, and that involved George Washington, as well as his brother-in-law, John Washington. And they established what's called Dismal Town. And it was sort of south of a town called Suffolk, Virginia, which is in the northwest sort of corner of the Great Dismal Swamp. So it's just south of that. And that canal, or that ditch, really still stands actually today in the refuge. But they established the settlement called Dismal Town. We don't know much about it from the historical record, but we do know John Washington stayed there pretty regularly, if not permanently, for the years he was there. And then, of course, the enslaved African American workforce stayed there and then worked in the swamp by day. So the canals were used to haul wood out, right, and get it to the market. And the wood, of course, was made into things like shingles, cooper staves, probably architectural lumber, you name it, right? And then turpentine was made and so on. So, but that adventurers project, or that sort of investment group, George Washington left it after a few years. I'm not entirely certain how long John stayed on, but it was longer than George. That kind of gave way after several years to this Dismal Swamp Canal Company. It's sort of like an offshoot, a developing, more substantial corporation or company that came around the late 1700s. We have evidence of ancient, right, use going back thousands of years by Native or Indigenous Americans of the swamp, and it turns out that they too gravitated to these areas of dry ground. Go figure, right? So what did they do 3,000 years ago or 4,000? Well, they sat there and they built cabins, or not cabins, but they built their homes or whatever it was, and then they used the stone tools and whatever else they had, made their ceramics, left in the ground like they did anywhere across the United States and elsewhere. Right? But it's there on these dry ground, these islands out in the swamp, and these people like Maroons, who are a big part of these sort of interior communities, right, as well as Native Americans, they're finding this old stuff that ancient people left behind, and they're bringing it up, right? It's part of their living world again. And they are using it, they're modifying it to attend to daily things, right, daily tasks. So we're finding that evidence. We're not finding the mass-produced stuff in the quantities we'd expect for a 1600, 1700, 1800 dated site, right? We're finding 95-98% even, right, sort of swamp available stuff being used and modified, right? And then a little bit, just a little bit, like 4-5-3% of the overall quantity of things we're finding come from that outside world. So it's actually really quite an interesting pattern, right, as we call it in archaeology. And what's important then is that, right, that pattern, right, and this is what archaeologists just tend to do anyway, but that pattern stands for, right, is a key representative or representation, right, of the lifestyle, the life ways of these communities out there. And so, you know, we have to imagine, right, because no documents recorded this for us. No one went out there and said, oh, this is how these people are living, and this is what, no one did that, not for this swamp, as far as we found. All right, so we don't have any sort of insider view. This is our only insider view, is looking in the ground, carefully excavating, right, recording everything we can, and then sitting in a place like this laboratory, analyzing stuff and coming up with some understanding of what this is all telling us. In this case, right, we have people, again, of whatever background, but primarily Native Americans and Maroons, going out to this island. Again, generation after generation, people going in, and they're all sitting there in that outside world, right? They've had enough, right? They've had enough of it. They've had enough of the brutality and the whatever else we want to think of. And they're going in the swamp, and then they're finding these communities of people that had the same evaluation, the same reaction, if you will, right, in the same action. They took control, essentially, and they went out in the swamp, and now here they are. How are they going to do this? Well, you know, they're not going to simply replicate, right, the world outside that they're trying to get away from, right? That, obviously, that's not going to happen. They're going to be sitting there thinking to themselves, how do we make our world better, right, in some sense of the word? And again, these ancient tools and ancient stones that were brought in by ancient peoples, right? They, what I call resuscitate, they resuscitated them, right? They brought them back into this realm of the living social world, whereas before they were deep in the ground, right? And now they're part of this community, and it becomes a key representation, like I said, of that sort of more self-reliant approach, to put it simply, right? So we're making our own stuff, we're relying on the ancient work and labors, right, of ancient peoples, because they brought the stuff out and they made those tools, and now they're gonna, the Maroons and others in the communities are modifying them or using them in their modern moment. And then, of course, they're gonna rely on the organic materials of the swamp. And so even though we don't have much of that survived, but we have the sort of footprints of dark soil of their cabins, so we know, I mean, again, this is not surprising, but they use swamp wood to build the cabins. They use some of that sand of the islands, right, and some of the lower levels of clay that have been, you know, deeper in the ground of those islands, right, to sort of patch the sides, right, to sort of fill in the cracks of the sides of the cabin, and so forth. So they're just sort of, you know, kind of doing what they have to, but it's also, they're creating a pretty impressive social world. It's not a case of going out in the swamp and, oh no, it's a horrible, horrible place. I mean, no, they're making a very dynamic sort of social world out there, and I think they're pretty happy with it. Otherwise, we wouldn't see 250 or more years of continuous use. So it is not uncommon to read about Maroon communities in, say, the swamps of Louisiana or elsewhere in the hemisphere, growing rice, right, in swampy environments. And then the community itself goes out and cultivates, or rice and other grains. And also, even on the island, we expect, I haven't found strong evidence yet, but I'm sure it's there to be found, of gardens, right, and that drier, sandy ground they're living on. And there they grow their gourds and whatever else they, tomato, garlic, doesn't matter, whatever they wanted to grow that didn't need to be sitting there in standing water. So, in any case, right, so they're, again, they're not going out of the swamp to go, you know, steal a hog or steal a cow or whatever necessarily all the time for food. They're growing their own. The swamp also has its share of wildlife, so they probably, one way or another, occasionally anyway, ate the flesh of other beings. However, we're not finding a lot of evidence for that yet, just so you know. Usually we find a lot of bones if people are relying on meat for, you know, typical meal or meals, but we're not finding that nearly as much as you might expect. So I wouldn't say we have evidence for a strong reliance by any means. So I think there's an emphasis on the plants growing the food, and occasionally, surely, right, eating animals one way or another. So a lot of stuff, consumables, right, marketable material stuff was going up and down these canals, and some of it was ending up in the hands of company workers, such as the ones that lived at this other site I worked at and the Cross Canal. And so, in any case, right, 1800s when this starts happening, roughly, again, the boom anyway, for the canals. So you gotta imagine this pretty good sized swamp. There are six, seven new canals, relatively new canals being dug, or they're finished. Now you got the lumbering going on. But in between all those canals are still these very remote places, all right? And when we say in between canals, we're still talking hundreds of square miles potentially, right, between this canal or that canal or whatever it might be. So there's plenty of space or land still for these resistance communities of Maroons and others, right, to stay and persist. But we also have to expect that that canal boom is going to change things. And that gets back to that initial question that I mentioned that we had for the nameless site, right? What's going on after around 1800 and after, right, at this site? And why do we see a potential change? And one of the things that I think happened was that these, at least at the nameless site, but probably for most interior, swamp interior communities of Maroons, right? Well, the community shrunk one way or another, and there's a good reason to think that. One was in the 1770s, there was the British Emancipation Proclamation, basically, that came out of Norfolk. Lord Dunsmore, his proclamation. And so we know several hundred people from all the counties around the swamp went, enslaved African Americans went and answered that, joined the British, right, because they were promised freedom. So we might expect that some people from these interior communities learned about it and then they left, right, one way or another. But think 20 years down the road then, so that happens, but also with the rise of the canal companies, one of the things that the documents suggest to us is that Maroons worked surreptitiously for the companies. And so what they ended up doing was coming up with this quota system, they being the canal companies, typically. And they kind of said, okay, right, you're going to lumber for us for the next year. That's the contract we have with your owner. If you produce X number, let's say 500,000 shingles, right, in the next, by the time you have to produce 500,000. If you produce 500,000, we're basically even. If you make more than 500,000, you will get paid for each additional shingle, some small amount, but it could add up quite significantly. And so it became this way, right, not only to develop skills for this enslaved workforce, right, members of the wider enslaved world, right, skills of lumbering and shingle making and so on, that was actually pretty much skilled labor at the time, one form of it, but also to make money. And you see quite a consistent reference in the 1800s documents, right, to people working in the canal companies, working for them, renting their labor out, hiring their time, as they called it, making this little bit of extra money, which typically enslaved people didn't have access to, right? And this idea of buying your freedom, right? It's discussed pretty regularly, right? So you save money, you do this year, and then the next year, and the next year, and the next year, God, you know, please let me, right? And eventually I can buy my freedom, is the dream, is the hope, right? Hand the person enslaving you $500 and they say, okay, you're free, and then okay. Or buy a loved one's freedom, which oft also comes up. It's sort of an alternative in many ways to that world outside, even though it's still connected with it, like I said, in terms of, you know, information flowing up and down canals and the stuff of that marketplace coming to the settlements, right? And here's an image, right, from the 1856 of one part of one of these settlements, and it shows a couple of the company workers in front of what looks like a work building.
While some individuals escaped alone, given their socio-cultural heritage, Maroons mainly fled in groups and banded together. What were these communities like in terms of their social and physical characteristics? How long did they remain in hiding?
One might presume that to survive as a community, you would need strong bonds, you would need, you know, a lot of loyal residents for the communities to survive. These communities were under pressure, and any given year, one could come under attack, you know, from slave patrols or even, in some cases, militaries, you know, national or colonial militaries would be marshaled in the service of slaveholders. So there's an important reason to think about, you know, what were the things that, you know, held people together as a community. This is especially important when we think of how many Maroon communities were really diverse in terms of the languages people spoke, different African and European languages, maybe even Arabic, different Native American languages being spoken. So because of some of that diversity, you know, that's just one type of diversity. We can also think of political ideologies and theologies. So, you know, for various reasons, we have to be thinking, you know, what was it that held people together, even though they were diverse? You know, it's important we don't broad brush folks and just think, oh, they're all Africans. They share African heritage. They share, you know, the experience of slavery. Therefore, they're all, you know, always loyal to the death, you know, and that wasn't the case in terms of what the chroniclers suggest to us. And in the Americas, a lot of people don't understand this, but a large number of Africans who came over across the Atlantic were Muslim before they got over here, right? So that's important because, you know, we often kind of think sometimes in the context of slavery, of Africans coming with indigenous practice, African practices, and we think of slaveholders having some form of Christianity, you know, as their guiding philosophical or theological value system. But Islam was equally a part of the mix, and some historians estimate as much as one third of the enslaved Africans who came over to the Americas were Muslim. People who escaped from slavery sometimes formed communities, and at other times they formed more short-term settlements. I think it's important to distinguish between the two, because you'll find different examples, you know, in the written records of people just escaping for maybe even a few days, just to get a short break, you know, from intense labor. At the particular site that I studied in Florida, Abrahamstown or Pilicocaja, that community existed for a whole generation, for almost 20 years. So I think that's a good example of how we can't overgeneralize in the short direction, you know, and shortchange them in terms of the fact that some people were able to establish communities and even raise children in these communities. You know, they lived in a state of relative stability for long enough for them to start perpetuating themselves. Places like Pilicocaja were on the long end of the spectrum in terms of the extent of these communities. Many of them were rather short-lived, but as Sylvain Diouf and other scholars have noted, some people escaped from slavery and actually kind of stayed outside of slavery, you know, after the Civil War even had occurred. So, you know, there were particular, you know, instances where some people were able to stay away, maybe not so much as communities, but sometimes as individuals or even as small family groups, you know, for decades or for years. You know, in the broader backdrop of Seminole history, a lot of communities were exclusively Seminole and it might have been exclusively African or Maroon peoples. So that's just a part of the bigger picture in terms of the options people had when they were escaping from slavery or the circumstances they encountered.
Martha Russell Beretta, I'm Executive Director of the Blanchard House Museum of African American History and Culture of Charlotte County, located in Ponte Gorda, Florida. Out of these inhospitable and inaccessible areas, they were able to build settlements. Florida was ideal, first of all, because there was so much swampland, and the climate, it was ideal for them. But when you look at what they had to do, which is what is I find of particular interest, is how do you take this diverse group of people, like the Seminoles, who remember came from different, spoke different languages. You had, just because they were African, did not mean that they were all from the same area or if they all spoke the same language. You had different ethnic groups. You had different languages. And so this group of people whose primary focus was freedom, had to build a new people. They had to start to make a new ethnic group, who were the Maroons. They had to find and to build and create a Creole language, because they had many different African languages. Now, what was special about the Maroons were that they were dedicated to their freedom, and they built autonomous, separate communities that were based upon African cultural principles.
Several dedicated archaeologists have taken teams into dense, unforgiving wilderness to search for tangible evidence of the existence of Maroon communities. One such community was Angola.
Looking for Angola started when Vicky Olda decided that the research done by Cantor Brown Jr. that revealed the archival from the archives that there was a Maroon community on the Manatee River, that evidence of that should be found, material evidence. And so she pulled together an interdisciplinary research team that included myself, another archaeologist, Terry Week, a cultural anthropologist, Rosin Howard, an educator, Lewis Robinson of Manatee County Schools, Herbert White, who's a public historian, as well as Cantor Brown Jr., the historian who first discovered this community through the archives. And the project was never just an archaeological endeavor. It always had a public component. We could call it public archaeology or public anthropology. The idea was that all through the research process, we'd share the questions and findings as we went along. And it's been a long process of making sense of the archival material, making sense of the geography, figuring out what has been done, what we know already, and how it fits with what we're finding, engaging in archaeological excavations, both terrestrial, on land, and underwater, taking both the shortcomings of the excavations, but also seeing some of the positive possibilities.
When we started looking for Angola, the archival resources told us that the Maroons settled in the southern part of Tampa Bay. We knew that they would be by the Manatee River and on the south side of the Manatee River. But the Manatee River is more than 60 miles long. We had a lot of area to consider. There are a few places that seemed likely but were difficult to access. One of the places that seemed possible was right by the Manatee Mineral Spring. We're about half a dozen miles from Tampa Bay, from the Gulf of Mexico. So it's inland enough so the Maroons, who had been worried about slave raiders coming in, would have enough distance from the coastline to give warning in case that Navy ships came in. And it was a source of water, fresh water. It's always of necessity for any peoples. It's right next to the Manatee River, so it becomes a natural southern natural defensive boundary. And this area by the Manatee Mineral Springs is preserved by a nonprofit historic preservation organization and had been since late 1990s, because this is where the village of Manatee began, with the original Anglo-American settlement of the region in 1842. This is where they settled. The Manatee Mineral Spring is a source of fresh water. Until the late 20th century, it was free flowing. It's since been capped. And the water flowed into a pool that provided fresh water, places for the community to bring the animals and the rest. And it's clear this has always been an important place in the history of the region.
Artifacts from various excavations have been recovered that can tell us about these communities.
So here we see an example, a few examples of the types of material culture found at Abrahamstown, such as this potsherd here, this clear glass bead, and this shard of olive green bottle glass. And these manufactured items are indicators of wider relationships that people had in the region. It wasn't the case that these Maroon communities were isolated islands. They, folks were in contact with merchants and with overseers and with soldiers even. So in some cases, some people who would later become their enemies. This cut nail is a classic example of a 19th century fastener. People used a variety of architectural styles and materials in building their houses, mostly wooden cabins from the descriptions of soldiers. And some soldiers, for instance, volunteers from Tennessee, described the houses as cabins with open rafters where meat and other things could be hung.
Okay, this is a replica of a white clay pipe, and we have fragments of pipes at Abrahamstown. Basically, you would be looking at a stem. Largely, most of the fragments were of the pipe stem, and we have some fragments of the pipe bowl. It was a much thinner bowl than this one. But this is, an example of what a whole pipe would look like. We don't have whole pipes. We find only fragments of them, but
people in their leisure time, or, you know, as part of their everyday life, you know, smoked tobacco like they do today. So this is largely what people were doing with these pipes. And tobacco smoking in some settings also had a spiritual significance in some Native American groups. This is an example of a coin that was discovered in the latter years of my fieldwork at Abrahamstown. It's a 1 cent piece, and on the other side it's stamped as 1843. Now that's a significant date because it's 7 years after Abrahamstown was destroyed by U.S. troops, and it's likely one of the first types of artifacts left by the settlers who came and inhabited Abrahamstown after it was deserted and then destroyed by the U.S. troops that came through the region.
This is a replica of a drum that was found in 1967 by a fisherman on the Little Manatee River. Angola was on the Manatee River. Tampa Bay has four rivers going into it. One of them is the Manatee, one's the Little Manatee, and there's two others. The Little Manatee River is just north of the Manatee River. It was pulled out of the riverbank by this fisherman, and he was curious about it. The covering wasn't on it, of course. It was just the wooden part was there, and he put some effort into trying to figure out what it was. And it was academics at the University of Florida were able to identify it as a drum, and it's been at the Florida Museum of Natural History ever since. This particular object is really interesting and really just intriguing in so many levels. Because Jane Landers, who's at the University of Vanderbilt University, is clear that it's an African-inspired drum. She published that identification back in 1999. Who was inspired to make this drum, we don't know. The fisherman didn't have the records. There's no reason really why he would have. And so I put this in front of you just with the possibility, but only the possibility, that it's part of this larger saga for the Maroons. In terms of its location, it would make sense that people fleeing southward down the Gulf Coast would have had to cross Little Manatee River. Whether they stayed at Little Manatee River as a haven or crossed over it, whether this drum, which was burnt over much of its area, was because of a violent attack or some ritual activity, we will never know. It gives us another sense of the complexities of these people. Much of the artifacts that I recovered are mass-produced goods. But these are people of African descent. They may also have had other goods. And drums are particularly important, obviously for music, but also as a mode of communication. In the quiet of the Florida swamps and hammocks of the early 19th century, the drum beat would have been heard over great distances. Being on rivers, the sound would have carried. And we try to imagine how the Maroons found the location that we call Angola. The drumming could have been part of that.
A great number of Maroons traveled south in search of freedom. How far south did they go?
Tracy, they used whatever means necessary. And that what we know, so those out of coastal Georgia and South Carolina, that have all since the 1600s, we have been told in this area that you can have your freedom if you make it down to Florida. So you have folks coming from out of Beaufort County, from Chatham County, Liberty County, making their way down, traversing, you know, the waterways, hugging the coastlines, again, hugging the waterways. But later on, folks in South Central Georgia are now also using the swamps and using those pathways also to get into Florida. And because Florida at one time is now open territory pretty much, the British and the Spanish. And so when these forces now leaving, guess what? This now becomes a vacuum for Native Americans also to go there, because we also know that the Native Americans are also traversing those ways to get down there. And you have Africans, so we're all simultaneously in this area, and we begin to now form societies. Each one, sometimes they are interwoven, but a lot of times they're independent, such as Angola that's in Florida.
We don't hear as much about the Southern Underground Railroad as we hear about the Underground Railroad that went north. However, as early as the 1600s, there was a Southern Underground Railroad. And in this Southern Underground Railroad, Africans escaping enslavement from South Carolina came to the land of refuge, which was Florida. As early as 1693, the King of Spain issued an edict that said that all Africans who escaped slavery and came to Florida could be free. And so Florida became the land of refuge.
Along the way, Maroons encountered different Native American tribes and groups of people. Many would go on to forge new societies and even strategic alliances.
And 1763, with the Treaty of Paris, when Spain ceded Florida to the British, then the Spanish took those Africans who were living there and they went to Matanzas, Cuba. Now, because Florida had this reputation as being a land of refuge, that did not stop Africans from coming to Florida. They found an alternative place of refuge, and this was with the Seminoles. Now, it's an interesting history about the Seminoles as well. The Seminoles were originally from the Creek Nation, the Creek Confederacy. And the Creeks had moved down from Alabama, Georgia, there in the area, and to northern Florida. But there was a band of those who broke off and who the Creek Confederacy called the Seminole, and what we know as the Seminole. Now, what was interesting about the Seminole, they were a diverse group of people. They spoke different languages, but they were also people who were victims of war, who were victims of oppression. And so you had these two groups of people, the Seminoles, who were themselves refugees, aligning with the Africans who were escaping slavery. They formed probably one of the most successful alliances of two oppressed groups. They had mutual interests and mutual enemies. The Seminoles needed to protect their land, and the Africans needed to protect their freedom. The alliance that they formed worked very well. What happened with that alliance is that when an African escaped and came under the protectorship of a Miko, who was a Seminole chief, this person, under this protection and being a quote-unquote Seminole slave, was able to stay free. He was not, could not be sent back to his original owner. So this worked out very well for the Africans. They were allowed to live separately. They were allowed to farm. Most importantly, they were allowed to have weapons. And because one of their main purposes, of course, was the protection that they worked with the, they were part of a military unit that worked together to protect the mutual interests of the Seminoles and of the Africans.
In spite of their alliance, it has been documented that Seminoles enslaved Africans. However, their concept of slavery differed from the European model.
Seminole slavery was different from the European slavery in that it did not have that same economic basis. A Seminole slave was usually one who was taken in war, captured in war, and was replaced, somebody who may have been killed. They might adopt that person, the Yamasees, they had, some of them were slaves, they had adopted them. And so that whole concept of owning someone was very different. And so that was in itself was a very freeing concept. Even if you were a slave of a Seminole, it was a very different kind of slavery for Africans. The Africans and Seminoles also were similar in their cultural beliefs. You know, according to Seminole culture, land didn't belong to one person. There was common ownership of land. Everybody worked the land. Everybody benefited from the land. That same concept of communalism was an African concept. And so in terms of spirituality, in terms of oral culture, in terms of collectivism, the Seminoles and the Africans were very much alike. And that, I'm sure, is what helped that alliance, not only having common goals of protection, but also being similar in terms of cultural beliefs. When you think about the Gullah who came down, and that's they really were the people now that we know that, who are the Gullah, that live anywhere from the coast of North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, Florida. These Gullah people were the people that escaped from South Carolina and came to Florida. They had to cross the St. Mary's River. That was the border between Florida, Georgia, and Florida. When they crossed that, they were free. But even after the British took over and even after this became an American colony, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. There was, because of this alliance, Africans felt free still to come to Florida.
These relationships were often complex. What were they like? Did the members of these diverse communities intermarry?
In many places, there are various types of relationships going on between Native Americans and free people of African descent, enslaved people, and Maroons. And in some cases, they're more complementary or mutually beneficial. In other cases, they're antagonistic. In the case of Florida, where I've done research, they were more complementary in terms of Africans and Native Americans living close to one another, in some cases living together, intermarrying in some cases. As I said earlier, that wasn't always the case in other parts of the Southeast. For instance, with the Catawba and Cherokee and other groups, they oftentimes would work, as to police the boundaries between the plantations and slaveholding areas, and the interior areas where the colonists weren't as much in power, and in the mountainous areas and other places of the forest. In some cases, we had people who would develop a certain sort of relationship where they might contribute a small portion of their crops. And the chroniclers talk about it as tribute. However, pre-existing social relationships among Seminole communities involved a certain form of collective offering to leaders, on behalf of the wider community. So I think there's reason why we should look with a certain critical lens at some of these archival sources and ask, is it tribute that we're talking about here, or is it collective support of the wider community? I think a variety of things were going on, as opposed to simple domination, particularly in the case of communities who were well armed and who were good at fighting. We have individuals in what became Florida, such as Juan Caballo, or John Horse, who had an African mother and a Native American father, and that he's an example of intermarriage and how people would have more intimate relationships, and how this actually directly resulted in the formation of a whole new type of people, right? People who have a shared set of heritages, that cross, African, African American, and Native American populations. So we have free, enslaved, and Maroon people coming together and becoming African Seminoles or Black Seminoles, depending on who you talk to. We have people, like I mentioned earlier, such as John Horse, who were direct products of the diversity of these communities, having African and African American and Native American parents, right, and kin. And the chroniclers talk about, family ties of different people, like John Horse, for instance. They would specify, oh, he has kin over here in Abraham's town, and he has other kin in other villages. So the chroniclers, the military, the colonists, they were aware of these family ties.